Well, amen. Are you glad to be here tonight? Let's say amen. Good and loud. Boy, I'm glad you're out on a Monday night. This is a great crowd. In fact, Brother Kim, this is a lot more than we had last Monday night. I am so glad you made an effort to come out. Now, you young people that are here tonight, I'm about to tell you something you don't even know. You're going to think I'm full of it, but I'm going to tell you the truth. There was a day in church when there was things we couldn't do in church. You older folks, y'all remember that? I remember we weren't allowed to chew gum in church. Oh. If you chewed gum, your mama'd slap your head right off. And now people blow bubbles while I preach. I remember we were never allowed to get up and go to the bathroom during church. Oh, if you got up and went to the bathroom during the message, you signed your death certificate right then. Your daddy would kill you the minute he got you home. And there was a third one, and I don't know if you were raised the way I was as a kid, but we were never allowed to look backwards in church. Oh, you had to look straight ahead. I mean, the back wall could be on fire. It didn't matter. Do not look back there. And tonight, I want you to do just that. I want you to set up on your pew a little bit. I want you to crook your neck around, and I want you to look and see who's not here tonight. Would you do that? Look around, and see if you can see somebody that's not here tonight. Keep looking, keep looking. Now, don't think of somebody that's in the nursery. Who's in the nursery tonight, Shirley? Who's in the nursery? Anybody know? Who? Kristen's in the nursery. Anybody else? Who? Yvonne. Don't think of Yvonne and Christy. They're back. Kristen, they're back there taking care of babies right now. They're serving the Lord. Don't think of them. But get one person that you do not see in this building right now. And what I want you to do is by 5 o'clock tomorrow afternoon, 5 o'clock, I want you to call that person up. You say, Brother Kent, what would I say to them? Well, I'm going to tell you exactly what to say. Soon as they answer the phone, I want you to go, hey, we missed you at the revival last night. And you have my permission to say this. You can say, that little fat evangelist is looking for you. Yeah, that's what I want you to tell them. You tell them, that little fat evangelist, he's looking for you. The first thing they're going to say is, he's looking for me? And you say, yes, he missed you at the meeting. You can come at 5:30 and eat dinner. Preaching starts at 7. Make that phone call. Now, we're going to go one step further. I'm going to ask you to make a promise. I'm going to ask you to put your hand up and say, Brother Ken, I believe in what we're doing, and I'll make a phone call by 5 o'clock tomorrow evening. I will do my very best to Now, I like that enthusiasm. Hold on. Put them down. Because I know how you Baptists operate. I've been one my whole life. Some of you are like, well, I'm just going to put my hand up and just shut him up. Do you know what the Bible says? The Bible says, liars will be friars. Now, if you're not going to do it, don't put your hand up. If you're just overbearing hateful, I'm not calling anybody. I don't care what he says. Then you just leave your old stinking hand down. But if you say, Brother Kent, I believe in what we're doing down at Bible Baptist. I believe Chickasha needs revival. I believe America needs revival. And I could do it in 60 seconds. Now, there's two ways you can do it. Number one, you could do it on your cell phone as you leave the building. Don't do it while I'm preaching. In fact, this is a good point to remember. People do not know you're in church tonight. It's Monday night. Reach down right now and turn that phone on silent so it doesn't go off in the middle of the message. You could do it as you leave in the lobby tonight. Or you could do it anytime tomorrow. You could even make a face-to-face contact. You don't even have to make a phone call. But Brother Kent, I will contact one person by 5 o'clock tomorrow night. All right, we're going to raise our hand and we're going to do it on the count of three. Get under conviction a little bit. Bow your heads. Some of you don't look convicted at all. All right, we're going to do it on the count of three. Are you ready? Look up here. Here we go. One. Don't lie. Keep your word. Two. Come on, everybody. We can all do this. This will be easy. Are you ready? And when we put them up, we're going to put them high and we're going to leave them up. Are we ready? Three. How many will help me? Get them up there. Get them up there. This is pretty good. Hold on. I need four more. Hold on. I need four more. I need one more from this section over here. Who's going to help me over here? I need one more. Come on. I need one more. Come on. Yes. Thank you. Need one more from this section. Who's going to help me here? Oh, thank you. Need one more right over here. Oh, thank you. One more over here on the right. Yes. Two. I got two back there. All right. Put your hands down. Brother Kim, we're going to have a great crowd here tomorrow night. Everybody's going to be making phone calls. Everybody's going to be inviting people to the revival meeting. And I am so glad that you're going to do that. And tomorrow night, I'm just going to tell you right now, tomorrow night, if the Lord will let me, I'm going to bring a very clear salvation presentation tomorrow night. That would be a great night to invite your lost co-workers, your lost relatives, and your lost neighbors, and bring them tomorrow night. Tell them they can even have free dinner tomorrow night. We're going to feed them. What's on the menu tomorrow night, Sue? What is it? Indian tacos tomorrow night. Ooh, those are delicious. So you want to be here tomorrow night. Come at 5:30. We'll preach at 7. Service will begin. Make an effort to bring lost people to the service. Well, you know, I've been coming to Bible Baptist doing revivals for many years. Been a member here for the last 18 years. And I've taught you my song many times. But let's sing my song, the one I love to sing. I sing the first line. You repeat after me. Now take a deep breath and don't do it wimpy. Come on, if it's wimpy, we'll do it over. It goes like this. I sing a new song. All right, that was wimpy. I can tell I've been gone long enough, you forgot it. I sing the first line, you repeat, and you gotta hit it hard. Are you ready? Take a deep breath. You kids ready? All right, let's sing it. I sing a new song.
I sing a new song.
Since Jesus came.
Since Jesus came.
Serve a new master.
Serve a new master.
Wear a new name.
Wear a new name.
Whoa. Road.
Have a new goal.
Know a new peace. Down deep in my soul. Give yourself a hand. Wow. You know, I teach that song all over America, and it'd be horrible if my home church did it badly, but you guys are great, and I hope tonight you've got that song in your heart. Maybe you came tonight and you're a visitor and you're not ever been to a church like this. You've never seen a preacher like this before. And sometimes they come in and you're like, you Christians are so happy. Well, you know why we're happy? Because we're saved. We're going to heaven. We're not better than you. We're forgiven. And you know what? We're on a train that's headed to heaven. And tonight we stopped at this depot. And we'd like you to get on board with us and go with us. And I'm going to tell you, when you get Jesus in your heart, you can walk a new walk, sing a new song. It's a wonderful thing. I hope you get that before you leave tonight. Well, Julie's going to come and sing just before I preach, and I usually know what she's going to sing. I don't even know where she's at. Oh, there she is. What are you going to do? You playing the piano tonight too?
Yeah, I'm going to try.
Okay, all right. You know, she didn't know how to play the piano when I met her.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I taught her, but... We went to Kalamazoo, Michigan, and someone had given us an old street preacher's organ. It was like a suitcase, and it opened up, and it had two pedals, and you pumped it. And She was about 7 months pregnant, 8 months, big old fat thing. And she'd sit over there and pump that organ and play the organ. When we started our first church, we had 13 people that first Sunday. I was the preacher, I was the usher, I was everything except for the special, and I think me and Julie sang it together that morning. But Julie knew how to play the guitar a little bit, but she taught herself how to play the piano, and she's used that talent for the Lord, and so tonight she's going to play and sing for us. All right, honey, come on.
Must I go and empty-handed, thus my dear Redeemer meet? Not one day of service give Him, lay no trophy at His feet. Must I go and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior soon? Not one soul with which to greet Him must I empty-handed go. Oh, not death, I do not falter, for my Savior saves me now. But to meet Him empty-handed, that thought now clouds my brow. Must I go and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior soon? Not one soul with which to greet Him must I empty-handed go. Oh, the years in sinning wasted, could I recall them now? I would give them to my Savior, to His will I gladly bow. Must I go and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior soon? Not one soul with which to greet Him must I empty-handed go. Oh, ye saints, arise, be earnest, up and work while it is day. The night of death o'ertake thee, strive for souls while still you may. Must I go and empty-handed? Must I meet my Savior soul? Not one with which to greet Him must I empty-handed go. Must I empty-handed go.
Thank you. Thank you, honey. Open your Bibles to the book of Acts, chapter number 8. Acts chapter number 8. We're going to begin in verse 1 tonight. As soon as you find your place, let's stand and we'll honor God's word as we read it by standing. I love to honor the word of God. I am one of those narrow-minded preachers. I do not believe the Bible contains the word of God. I believe it is the word of God. Every word of it. And it's good for us. As soon as we read the passage, I always invite folks to come to the altar and pray with me. We had a good group down praying yesterday. We'll do it again tonight. Maybe you didn't come and pray with me yesterday or yesterday night. Come on down and we'll spend a moment in prayer around the altar. There'll be plenty of room all the way around the front. We can pray on these front pews, or you could just kneel in the floor. There'll be room for everyone. If you're just really not comfortable coming down and praying with me, then you can just be seated after we read. That'll be fine. Or if you're physically unable, I understand completely. Acts chapter number 8. Let's begin in verse number 1. And Saul was consenting unto his death. Let me stop right there and tell you, I didn't have time to read all of chapter 7. But in chapter 7, the first deacon in the church, his name was Stephen, has just been murdered. He was stoned to death by an angry mob. And I want you to notice the Bible says very clearly that Saul, who will later become the Apostle Paul, he was consenting unto the death of Stephen. Now, Saul didn't throw a stone at Stephen, but the Bible says he did hold their coats while they stoned Stephen to death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Please note those three words. Except the apostles. The apostles did not leave Jerusalem. The believers did, but not the apostles. Verse 2. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial, and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house, and hauling men and women, committed them to prison. Therefore they that were scattered abroad went everywhere, preaching the word. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria, and he preached Christ unto them. And the people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out of many that were possessed with them. And many taken with palsies and that were lame were healed. And there was great joy in that city. Now drop down, if you will, to verse number 26 in the same chapter. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. And he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure, and had come to Jerusalem for to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, Go near, join thyself to this chariot. And Philip ran thither to him, and heard him read the prophet Isaiah. And he said, Understandest thou what thou readest? And he said, How can I, except some man should guide me? And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him. And the place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter. And like a lamb dumb before his shear, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray thee, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Of himself or of some other man? Then Philip opened his mouth, and he began at the same scripture, and he preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. I invite anyone who'd like to come on down and join me at the altar. We're going to kneel and pray. Everybody's welcome. Remainder, you can be seated. But you're welcome to pray with me. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Amen. We can kneel on the front pew also. Amen. Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, man, it's good to be in your house tonight. We've enjoyed the meal. We've enjoyed just sweet fellowship with other Christians. I know tonight some had to make extra effort to be here tonight, and I'm so glad they came, and I'm so glad they put you first in their life. Lord, tonight, we're praying for hearts to be awakened. I'm praying tonight for a stirring inside of a man. A stirring that is going to change someone else's eternal destination. It's going to change a family. It's going to change a soul. And I'm praying tonight that man would be ignited for you. Lord, tonight I pray for that woman. That woman that you have so much you want her to do. You've got such a wonderful plan for her life, but she's falling way short. Oh, I'm praying tonight you'd stir her heart. Bring revival. Bring a burning desire to tell people about Jesus. And then, Lord, if there is someone here tonight that doesn't know Jesus, they just don't know how good it is to be saved. In fact, they're looking at us like we're weird, Lord. Oh, I pray tonight your Holy Spirit would show them how good it is to be one of your children. Dear God, give me preaching boldness. Give me clarity of thought. I pray the distractions in this room could be very small. I pray for the next few moments, Satan would be bound and blocked from this auditorium. And I'm praying that your Holy Spirit could do office work in hearts tonight. God, we give you this service. We know if you can't do it, nobody can. It's yours. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, I want to key on verse 35. The Bible says that Philip opened his mouth and preached unto him Jesus. I believe tonight with all my heart, this may be the greatest need in all of Christianity today. This may be the greatest need at the Bible Baptist Church of Chickasha. We don't need theologians. We don't need people that can dissect the Word of God. We need people that can just open their mouth and tell people about Jesus Christ. Folks, let's just be honest. Time is short. If you take the newspaper in one hand and the Bible in the other hand, they read together today. Everything is being fulfilled. We just had a group come back from Israel. And when you go to Israel, they're already preparing for the coming of the Lord. Everything is in place. I don't see anything on the calendar that prevents the trumpet from blowing tonight. And there comes a point where we as Christians have got to decide we don't have much time left. We need to open our mouth and tell people about Jesus. I always loved the story of the son that loved to buy his mother outlandish Mother's Day gifts. Every year they were bigger and bigger and more wonderful. And he was out one day and he saw two parrots that would talk and converse with you. And he thought those would be wonderful. My mother could talk to these parents and they would keep her company. And they were $5,000 apiece. And he bought them and shipped them to his mother. And 2 weeks later, he called and he said, "Mom, did you get my Mother's Day gift?" She said, "Oh, yes, I did. Thank you so much. They were delicious." He said, "Mom, you didn't eat those parrots. Those parrots could talk." She said, "Well, they should have said something." I fear in my heart that some of us are going to stand as the audience at the great white throne. And we're going to see our friends. And we're going to see our neighbors. And we're going to see our family stand before God just before they're cast into the lake of fire. And we're going to weep and say, "I should have said something. I should have opened my mouth." Because I really believe that every day of our life, God gives us opportunities to open our mouth and tell people about Jesus. Several years ago, we were traveling in Southern California. I had Julie and Elizabeth with me at that time, and we had a big motor coach, and we were in Redondo Beach, California, preaching that meeting, and the next week we were going to be up in the Simi Valley, and so we had Thursday, Friday, and Saturday off between our meetings. And whenever I was in Southern California in Hollywood, I'd take the Julie and the kids, and we'd go to Hollywood and we'd see a sitcom being shot, or we'd go down to the Chinese theater and see a premiere and the stars pulling up in their limos. And the only problem that year was there was a writer's strike, and all the studios were closed down because they were on strike. And when I went online to try to get tickets for a show, the only shows you could get a ticket for were the game shows. Price is Right, Jeopardy, The Wheel of Fortune. And so I thought, well, we got to do something, so let's go see Jeopardy. So we went down to Culver City, California to the Sony Pictures studio, and they filed us into that studio, and we walked between those big studios, and they said, look around. This is where they made The Wizard of Oz. You are walking right where the yellow brick road was in the famous movie. And then they took us down to the entrance of Jeopardy, and they said, now we're going to take you through a metal detector, and you're going to go in and sit down. And we want to tell you that during the taping of the show, Alex Trubeck likes to turn to the audience and take questions. Now, I'm just going to warn you, Alex has kind of a Don Rickles type personality. If you ask a stupid question, he'll laugh at you and make fun of you. And if your feelings get hurt, be careful what you're asking. He's highly intelligent. Also, we must ask that you do not ask him any personal questions. If you ask him a personal question, you will instantly be asked to leave the studio. So we got into the studio. I'm sitting on the aisle on the third row, Julie and Elizabeth beside me, and sure enough, people ask questions, you know, like, do you ever ask the same question twice? And he had a funny answer for that, and people were asking questions, and they shoot all five shows in one day. You know, if you watch it all week long, they go back, change clothes, and they come out and say, now it's Tuesday, and now it's Wednesday, but it's all done in the same day. And we were about three shows. We were probably on Wednesday. And Alex walked over to a little wall they had there. And I was on the third row. I was about where my buddy is right here. And Alex said, anybody got a question? And my hand went up. And Julie looked at me instantly like, no. Because she knew what I was going to ask. Yes, sir. I said, Alex, I'm a Baptist preacher, and I've noticed that there's a lot of questions on Jeopardy about the Bible. I've even heard you make reference to the Bible. Alex, are you a student of the Bible? Alex, are you a believer? And I'm going to tell you, when I said that, it was like all the oxygen got sucked out of that studio. I mean, every cameraman turned around to see. Security guards came down the steps. One stood right beside me. You can ask Julie. She thought I was gone right then. And Alex looked at me. And at that time, he was wearing a mustache and a little goatee. And he started rubbing it. You could hear a pin drop in that studio. Everybody had turned to look. He climbed up into his little Alex Trubeck director chair and just looked at me. And all of a sudden he said, I was raised a Catholic in Canada. And I have a lot of born again friends, but I wouldn't say I'm born again. In fact, I think religion is going to lead a lot of people to hell. That's what he said. And I said, Alex, let me tell you, I agree with you 100%. You see, Alex, it's not religion that's important. You know what's important, and God gave me this. I have no clue where it came from, but God. I said, you know what's important, Alex, is the question that Larry King was asked on the Larry King show one night. And I was trying to relate to a showbiz person with a showbiz illustration. And he said, well, what was Larry King asked? And I said, Alex, one night on the Larry King show, he was asked this question. If you could interview God and ask him one question, what would you ask God? And that really interested Alex. And he said, well, what did Larry King say? And I said, when Larry King was asked if you could interview one person and ask God one question, what would you say? And Alex said, what did he say? He said this, do you have a son? And if you do, was his name Jesus? And I said, Alex, that's what's important. Not religion, but do you know Jesus? And he was holding his cards and he said, well, I got to get back to the show. And he got up to his little podium and he went through another series of questions. And all of a sudden the director said, and cut. And as soon as the director said cut, he turned and came straight at me. He said, well, the problem I have with the Bible, I can't believe that the earth is 6,000 years old. I said, oh, Alex, we've proven that carbon black dating is incorrect. And in Glen Rose, Texas, there's a fossil with a dinosaur and a man's foot over it. How did that happen? And he goes, I got to get back to the show. The director said, cut. Here he came again. For the next 45 minutes, it wasn't questions and answers. It was Kent York and Alex Trubeck having a running debate. And finally, he said to me, on the last segment, we were about to break for lunch. He said, well, I'm glad we live in a country that if I don't agree with you, you're not going to pull out a gun and kill me. And if you don't agree with me, you're not going to stop watching my show. That's what he said to me. And I said, oh, Alec, we love you. In fact, I've got a mama home in Chickasha, Oklahoma, and she watches you every day. But I'm going to tell you something, Alex. She's going to be really disappointed in you when I tell her about this conversation, and the whole studio bust out laughing. Well, that was the end of it. The next week, we preached another meeting. Still the writer's strike was on. The only ticket I could get was to the Wheel of Fortune. So we went to the Wheel of Fortune. Well, the Wheel of Fortune and Jeopardy are run by the same company, King World. Their studios are side by side. Same cameramen, same director, same security people. The only thing that's different is the stars and the announcer. And all of a sudden, the security guy comes down beside me, and he looks down and goes, you're that Baptist preacher from Jeopardy last week. And I'm thinking, oh, no. And he squats down beside me, and he says, I'm a Christian. And that was so cool. He said, we have a Bible study on the set of Jeopardy and the Wheel of Fortune every morning. In fact, I got this job because I go to church with that guy right over there. We have a Bible study. And he said, you wouldn't believe the next morning when we showed up to work, everybody walked in and said, yeah, that Baptist preacher, he burned Alex to the ground. They said, we've been too intimidated to ask him whether he's a Christian. And now we know he's lost. And we've been praying for Alex to get saved. Well, as soon as the shooting of the Wheel of Fortune was over, his name was Michael Mitchell. And Michael said, I'll take y'all on a tour of the studio. And he took us on a walking tour of the Sony Picture Studio. And while he was walking, he was showing us stuff. But he told me, he said, Brother Kent, I know you thought you were just having a debate with Alex last week, but what you did went completely through this studio to every Bible study on this soundstage, and they were encouraged because someone had the courage to stand up and open their mouth and tell him about Jesus. And I'm going to tell you right now that every one of you, if we would wake up and just realize that every day of our life, God gives us opportunities to open our mouth and talk to someone about Jesus and not be afraid, but just do it for the glory of God. And tonight I want to look at Philip, because Philip had some great characteristics for opening his mouth. You know, the overriding characteristic that I've got to start with is that Philip had a great amount of courage. Now, just think with me a minute. They had just stoned to death the first deacon in the church, Stephen. In fact, when he left Jerusalem, they were burying the chairman of the deacon board. If you go back to Acts chapter 6, where they chose seven men of honest report, what we call the first deacons of the church, the first man chosen was Stephen. The second man chosen was Philip. We might say Stephen was the chairman of the deacon board and Philip was the vice chairman. Now, if they had just killed the chairman of the deacon board, Brother Kim, could you hear that deacon meeting? You know, it might be good for us to cool it for a while. It might be a good idea if we just shut up, because the only reason Stephen got stoned to death was because Stephen wouldn't shut up. Stephen preached a message that cut them to their heart, and they rushed him and they killed him. But I want you to notice Philip was no little pansy Christian. Philip didn't keep his mouth shut. While they're burying Stephen, Philip goes straight down to the city of Samaria and starts preaching Jesus Christ. He was a man of great courage. And I'm going to be very, very honest with you. If you're going to open your mouth and tell people about Jesus, it will take every bit of courage you've got. And let's start where it's the hardest. Witnessing to your own family. Brother Kim, I'd just soon witness to anybody than my own family. Your own family, they know you. They remember when you were young and you sowed your wild oats. Some of them were sowing it with you. They remember when you got mad at the family reunion. Someone beat you at dominoes and you cussed out three people. You see, your family knows you warts and all. And you can play Holy Joe with a stranger, but you cannot play Holy Joe with your own family. They know you. And I'm going to tell you right now, there's some of you in this room that have lost daddies and mamas and brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles and grandchildren and children that do not know Jesus. And it will take every bit of courage you've got to open your mouth and tell them about Jesus. I remember several years ago, I was your staff evangelist, but we lived in Arkansas. And I was coming to town for one day. I was going to see Brother Kim and do some other things. I had one day in Chickasha. I was traveling through. And I called my mother and I said, "Mom, I'm coming to town tomorrow." And she said, "Oh, good. Your Uncle Lester is having surgery at 6:30 in the morning at St. Anthony Hospital. And Kent, you know Uncle Lester, he's not saved. Do you think you could drive up to St. Anthony and talk to him about Jesus?" And I remember my answer. "Well, Mom, I've only got one day. I'm just coming through." And you know how your mom talks to you. "Oh, I understand. You're a busy man." I could hear the tone of her voice. I said, "Okay, I'll be there." I had to get up before daybreak and go to St. Anthony, and I got up there to the hospital room, and Uncle Lester's sitting up in the bed. The room is packed with family, and you say, "Is all your family like you?" "Yes, we're all nuts, huh?" People are screaming and yelling and laughing. It's 5 o'clock in the morning. It's like a zoo in there. I go over and stand in the corner and I'm thinking, there's no way I'm going to talk to him about the Lord. I mean, look, this room's jammed. And I'm going to tell you, it was like the hand of God went in there. And everybody went out into the hallway. And I kid you not, it was me and Uncle Lester standing in that room. And I walked up beside his bed. And I said, "Uncle Lester, how do you stand with Jesus?" And he said, "Not very good." And I took my Bible out and I took him through the Romans road. And he prayed the sweetest prayer and asked Jesus to save him that day. He barely said amen and the door flew open and everybody came right back in. You talk about just a window of opportunity. Uncle Lester never went to church. He lived at the golf course. He smoked like a chimney his whole life. They'd spotted a spot on his lung, and your lung has three lobes, and he had cancer in the middle lobe. The surgeon was going to go in and take out the center lobe, and they did that morning. They went in and took the center lobe of his lung. They came out and said, "We got all the cancer. It all went beautiful. It's all wonderful," and we were so happy. 3 days later, he's sitting up in his bed, eating breakfast, and a blood clot kicked loose and went to the base of his brain and killed my uncle instantly. 3 days later. Oh, I'm so glad I went up there that morning. I'm so glad I mustered every bit of courage. My Uncle Cecil was the same story down in Ardmore. Smoked his whole life. Most of my family started smoking when they were 8 years old. Dying of cancer. Dad said, "You want to go with me?" And I said, "Yeah, I'll go." The room cleared out and there was Uncle Cecil and me. "Uncle Cecil, how do you stand with Jesus?" He said, "Not very good." Same answer. I told him about Jesus. He got saved, and I'll never forget. The tears ran down his eyes, and I brought a box of Kleenex, and he got two big handfuls of Kleenex, and he was wiping his face. And the door flew open, and it was my Aunt Frances. She's a big Jehovah Witness. I was on that side of the bed. She come to this side of the bed, and she took Cecil's hand, my Uncle Cecil, and she began to rub it. And she said, "Cecil, honey, I don't think you're going to make it into the kingdom. But I want you to know I loved you." And my Uncle Cecil turned and said, "Franny, I'm going to heaven because Kent just showed me how to get saved." And she looked at me. And I was like, "Nee, nee, 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 nee." My Aunt Frances died this winter. Me and Mom drove to Shawnee, Seminole, Oklahoma for the graveside. I wasn't going to go to the Kingdom Hall. They were going to have that a week or two later, but they were having a graveside for just the family. It was a blustery old cold day, and we were under that tent. They're all Jehovah Witnesses. But they made a real error that day. They said, "If anybody would like to say a word, well, you know what? I'd like to say a word." So I waited for all of her children to have their say. And then they said, "Okay, Kent." And I told them about Jesus. And I told them about how 50-something years ago, my daddy took his sister Franny in a car and led her to Jesus Christ. And I'm holding on to the hope that she truly did get saved, even though the Jehovah Witness sucked her into their false doctrines. I'm holding on to the hope that my Aunt Frances got saved. And I told them and their children and their grandkids, "If you ever are going to see this lady again, there's only one way to see her, and that's through the shed blood of Jesus Christ." Their eyes were that big around. They called on a Jehovah Witness afterwards to say a word, and she went, "I don't know what to say after that." You know what? I'm telling you these stories to tell you that wasn't easy for me. This is my family. I love these people. They're my blood. But it will take every bit of courage to talk to your family. You need to go to your daddy and your mama. Some of you senior saints, you need to talk to those grandbabies and that grandson and daughter. You need to go down to McDonald's and have a Coke and a hamburger and talk to them about Jesus Christ. Some of you need to call up your aunt and uncle and bake a cake and go over there and have coffee and talk to them about Jesus Christ. "Oh, Brother Kent, if I do They'll get mad at me. Well, you know what? If they get saved, they'll get over it the first 1,000 years in heaven. But I'm going to tell you something. They're first, second in hell. They're going to curse your name if you never told them about Jesus. You see, Philip opened his mouth because he was courageous. Secondly, I want you to notice that he was obedient. Do you see how the scripture reads here? Very different than the way we interpret it today. Look at the obedience of Philip. Drop down there to verse 26. Let's read it again. And the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip. Woo! This is the angel of the Lord speaking to him. Arise, go toward the south unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. The angel told him exactly what to do. Look at the very next verse. What does Philip do? And Philip went to the Christian bookstore and started checking out books about Gaza. Then he began to check and see if other churches would support him on his journey to go to Gaza. Then he began to check and see if there was a Walmart in Gaza so his wife could have shopping while he... You're like, what version are you reading? That's today's version. No. Verse 27 says, he arose and, whoo, he went. Drop down to verse number 29. Again. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near, join thyself to this chariot. Go up there. The very next verse, and Philip ran thither to him. Now remember, Philip's not an apostle. He's not a preacher. He's not a man of God. He's a layman. He's a regular guy, just like you. But guess what? He was a regular guy that was obedient to what God wanted him to do. Now, I just got to be honest with you, and I'm just going to throw this out because I'm sick of this in the church. I'm sick of this little phrase. Well, we're praying about it. Oh, that sounds so spiritual. I've actually had people come up to me and go, Brother Kent, I'm not saved, but we're praying about it. You're praying about getting saved? Who are you praying to? Then the next one is, well, we got saved, and Brother Kim, we're praying about getting baptized. There's nothing to pray about. The Bible says you get saved, you get baptized. There's no prayer meeting needed. You just need to be obedient to the Word of God. There's some in this room tonight. You've been saved, but you've never been in that tank yet. You know what? What are you waiting for? Don't pray about it. Do it. Well, we're praying about being regular in church. The Bible already told you to do it. Forsake not the assembly. You ought to be a member of a church. There's some of you in this room tonight. You've been attending this church for a long time. You ought to join this church tonight. You ought to just go down there and say, I like this church. Brother Kim Hayes is preaching the word. I want to get in there and get busy. I'm running my flag up this flagpole. Instead of sitting out there and being a spectator. Brother Kim, we're really praying about it. Well, we're praying about tithing. Bible says 10% belongs to God. That needs to be in the offering plate. No prayer needed. Yeah, you want them to do that twice? And then missions the same way. We ought to be communicating. And the word communicating in the New Testament, it means giving money to missionaries. We don't have to pray about it. I mean, we've learned the lingo so well. And we sound so spiritual. I'm so spiritual. I pray about everything. I think some of you pray about getting out of bed in the morning. No, you just do it. You see, Philip was obedient. When the Spirit of God told him to do something, he did it. And I'm going to tell you, every day of your life, you're going to be sitting down here at McDonald's having breakfast and someone sits down beside you. You're going to be down at the beauty shop waiting to get your hair fixed. You're going to be down at the laundromat waiting for your laundry to get dried. You're going to be out at a restaurant and a waiter comes up. And you know what? The Spirit of God says, talk to that person. Give them a gospel tract. Tell them about Jesus. In fact, you ought to be out there just waiting for it. And I'm not going to ask for a show of hands right now, but you know what? How many of you got a gospel tract on you right now? How many of you could give a gospel tract to someone right now? How many of you could reach in your pocket and pull out a tract that says, do you know for sure if you died today, you go to heaven? If you don't, you're hunting without bullets. Philip was obedient. Thirdly, when the eunuch says, I'm reading in Isaiah, but I don't understand it. How can I unless someone show me? You know what Philip did? He went to the same scripture and he taught Jesus. Because the passage he was reading was a prophetic truth about the coming Savior, Jesus Christ. The lamb that went to slaughter. You know what the third quality of Philip was? He knew the Bible. You know what I hear around the church all the time? You really need to get saved and we need to make an appointment to come down and see Brother Kim. Because Brother Kim has the get saved magic dust. I don't have it. It's only on, it's on Brother Kim. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. Every Christian ought to know the Bible well enough that he could lead someone to Jesus Christ. I hate to say it, but a Jehovah's Witness or a Mormon can pin a Baptist in about 5 minutes on your front porch. You know why? They know their stuff better than you know your stuff. That's embarrassing. I had a guy come up to me the other day in a church and he said, Brother Ken, I had two Jehovah's Witnesses come on my porch and I ran out there and said, get off my property and don't you ever come back. Is that good? I said, well, that ain't exactly the way I handle it. When them JWs come to my porch, I'm like, well, hello. Let me get the Bible. And you know, you never can talk those older ones, but they always bring little kids with them. And I talk to the little kids. And in about 15 minutes, they're like, sir, we can see you're not really interested. We really need to go. No, don't leave yet. We're not done. They're crawling off my porch. They're begging to leave. If you know your stuff, you can do that.
Well, Brother Ken, I'm not a preacher like you. I didn't go to Bible college.
Get your computer out and Google it. Google, how do I confuse a Jehovah's Witness? There's 1,000 websites. Get your ammunition and then watch for them.
Some of you don't believe me, but go home tonight and do that.
Google it.
The Bible says study that you may be approved a workman that rightly divides the word of truth. I'm going to tell you, if all the Bible you're getting is coming from this guy 3 times a week, you are an anemic Christian. You need to get in the book and learn it. Praise God for our FBI, Faith Bible Institute, and our other Bible studies we have. Praise God for you that are going through that. You know what that tells me? You're trying to learn the book. Rest of you say, you're trying to make me guilty. You got it. Toyota. Philip knew the Bible. And lastly, he knew Jesus. You see, if you don't know Jesus, you can't win others to Jesus. W.A. Criswell, the pastor of the First Baptist Church in Dallas for years, he used to say that he thought he was preaching to 80% lost every Sunday. I hope our statistic of Bible Baptists is better than that. But there's some of you masquerading as Christians. And the evidence is you don't ever win anybody to Christ. Because I understand it's hard to win people to Christ if you don't know Him yourself. Verse 8, the Bible says that Philip went down to the city of Samaria and he preached. And what happened? Great joy broke out. You show me a person that wins souls, and I'm going to show you people that have got a lot of joy going on around them. Hey, do you ever hang out with Brother Kim? A lot of joy around Brother Kim. You know why? Because Brother Kim's a soul winner. And there's happy people around him. Some of you, there's no joy around you at all. In fact, some of you look like dead lice are falling off of you. You know why? Because you're not a soul winner. If you were a soul winner, you'd be living around joyous people. He knew Jesus. And he shared it with others. Well, one more thought and I'm done. What happened? Well, in this story, one man got saved. I know in evangelism, we like to advertise big numbers if we can. I was in San Antonio the other day. We had 26 saved in that revival, and I've been bragging about it ever since. Bragging on Jesus. Philip didn't have 26 saved. He had one. An Ethiopian eunuch. From everything I've studied, this is the first black man ever saved. We might actually say that Philip opened the continent of Africa to the Lord. Our missionary Steve Vellante, he owes a debt of gratitude to Philip because Philip won the first one. Brother Steve's winning more. Because I want to believe that that Ethiopian eunuch went back to Ethiopia and he shared his faith with others. And from that, others got saved and others got saved and churches got planted. And if you know anything about Africa today, I was just recently the keynote speaker at a mission conference with a missionary from Tanzania. And they will tell you that Tanzania and Kenya are some of the most fruitful mission fields in the world today, with thousands and thousands of people coming to know Christ. I read the other day that Bible sales were the greatest on the continent of Africa than any other continent of the world. And you know what kind of Bibles they're buying? King James Version of the Bible. It's amazing. They're buying English Bibles. And it all started with one. And the last point I want to make is this. If you will open your mouth and tell one, you will not know until eternity how far that's going to spread. How far it's going to go. My family is living proof of that. My dad come out of World War II. 1945. He was in love with my mother and she lived in Crossville, Illinois. They were going to get married and it was 2 weeks till the wedding. My dad needed a job for 2 weeks. He went out and knocked some doors and he found a job with a company called the Superior Oil Company. At that time, the Superior Oil Company was the world's largest driller of oil. Today, they're part of the Mobil Exxon group. That two-week job turned into a 17-year career for my dad. And during that career, they transferred him to a little town in Oklahoma called Chickasha. Mom and Dad lived down in a little wood house, a little wood frame house. It's still there, down there on 12th Street, about two blocks from the old church building. My dad was a cigarette smoking, drinking, cussing, old well worker. My mama was a Christian. My dad would not go to church. He would only, in fact, let her go to Sunday school because he was a big family man and Sunday was his only day off. And he wanted her back at the house because we're going on a picnic, we're going for a drive, we're going fishing, and he was a big family man. You know what Mom did? She went to Sunday school and came back. I hear women today, "Well, Brother Kim, I would come to church, but my husband doesn't want to go." I'm so glad I didn't have a mother like that. You know what my mother did? She did what she could get away with. And she took my brother and sister and they went to Sunday school every Sunday. They went down to the Calvary Baptist Church on 13th Street. Well, because she went to Sunday school, it gave that crazy preacher down there an excuse to come see my dad. The preacher was a lunatic preacher. His name was J. Curtis Goldman. If you ever knew Brother Goldman, you know I'm not making fun of him. He was a lunatic. He came to my dad's house almost every Thursday night. My dad would laugh at him and blow smoke in his face. It was mission conference week at Calvary. Dr. Frank Hoagie to the Philippines was the missionary. They were in a car that day and Brother Goldman took a wrong turn. And you know it's hard to make a wrong turn in Chickasha. I mean, it's like a waffle iron around here. But that wrong turn went in front of Mom and Dad's house. My dad was out in the yard, working in the yard. And Goldman had his window down and he yelled, "Hey, Jack York, what are you doing?" And my dad waved like this, "Pull in." Brother Goldman looked at the missionary and said, "This guy never wants to talk to me, but he's waving me in. I better stop." So they got out of the car and said, "Jack, what do you want?" And he said, "My mother-in-law's here, and she's a big Baptist, and I knew you'd want to meet her." So the preacher said, "Well, let's meet your mother-in-law." And they walked in that house, and there was Grandma, used to be a member of this church. She died at 104 years old several years ago. My dad called her Nanny. He said, "Nanny, this is that Baptist preacher, and I knew you'd want to meet him." My grandma said, "Brother Goldman, thank you for witnessing to my son-in-law, and I wish you'd keep it up." And Brother Goldman said, "Well, ma'am, I'm sorry to tell you, but I've given up on him." And my dad said, "Well, don't give up." He said, "Well, I have, Jack. I come over here, you blow smoke in my face, you won't listen to me. I've given up." "Well, don't give up on me." He said, "Yeah, I have. I've given up on you." "Well, don't give up." Brother Goldman said, "All right, Jack, I won't give up. You know right now you need to be saved. Wouldn't you trust Christ right now?" Mom and Grandma said, "You could have cut the tension in that living room with a knife." As they stood in a circle, that little frame house with a wooden floor. And all of a sudden, my daddy fell down at Brother Goldman's knees and said, "Yes, I want to be saved." And Brother Goldman got down on the floor with my dad and led him to Christ. And when my dad got up, my dad said, "What do I do next?" Brother Goldman said, "Come to church in the morning and tell everybody you got saved." And he did. After the morning service, my dad said, "What do I do next?"
You come tonight, bring a change of clothes, and we're going to baptize you. And they did. After church Sunday night, he said, what do I do next? He said, go to work tomorrow and witness to the men you work with. 6 o'clock Monday night, the doorbell rang at Goldman's house, and he went to the front door, and there was my dad. Preacher, get your Bible. We got to go talk to these men. Brother Goldman grabbed his Bible, got in the front seat with my dad. My dad pulled out his Pall Malls, put one in his mouth, and Brother Goldman said, pull over, drop me off. And Dad said, why? If you're going to smoke, I'm not going with you. And boy, my dad put them cigarettes away. And they went out that night, and won 3 or 4 men to the Lord. Tuesday night, he was back again. They won more men. Brother Goldman wrote in his book, he said, the most fruitful days of my ministry was winning souls with Jack York every night of the week. Superior Oil Company transferred Dad and Mom to Whitesboro, Texas. They hated to leave Chickasha, but they got transferred. Back then, you didn't move to a new town and visit the churches. You went to your pastor and said, we're moving, where do we go to church? And Brother Goldman said, when you get to Whitesboro, you go to the Central Baptist Church. The pastor there is a wonderful man, but he looks like a monster. The pastor was Ted Hicks. Big, tall, over 6 foot tall pastor. But he'd been a drunk in his early years. And he flipped his car over on the Red River Bridge one night on an icy night. And the radiator water and the battery acid poured across his face. And if you ever saw Brother Hicks, he had the most hideous face. They had done many, many patching of skin and rebuilt his ears and his nose. He looked like a monster. Mom and Dad came that morning, walked down the aisle and joined the first Sunday because their pastor told them to. My dad went straight to Brother Hicks and said, what night is visitation? And he said, I'm sorry to tell you, we don't have visitation. You see, there was 2 families in the church that believed that he had no business being pastor, and they wanted him to resign. And Brother Hicks was under such depression and discouragement, he wasn't even out in public. He was just going from home to church. He had not been in public in maybe 6 months. He looked horrible. He was depressed. In fact, late in life, Brother Ted Hicks told me, the Sunday your mom and dad joined our church, I wasn't contemplating resigning. I was contemplating suicide. He was that discouraged. Monday night, Brother Hicks' doorbell rings and my dad's on the porch. Preacher, you said you don't have visitation, but give me your prospect cards and I'll go visit the prospects. Brother Hicks said, I don't have one prospect. Brother Ted told me your dad walked out on the porch and put his hands on his hips and looked at me. And he said, preacher, grab your coat. We'll go knock some doors and we'll get some prospects. They went out that night and won 2 or 3 people of the Lord knocking doors. A great revival broke out in the Central Baptist Church, and Brother Hicks' ministry was saved. And he moved to Santa Ana, California, where he became the founder and the president of the Pacific Coast Baptist Bible College, which served in San Dimas, California for many years. Today they've moved to Oklahoma City, and it's called the Heartland Baptist Bible College. And to this very day, it's sending preachers and missionaries all over the globe. Later, my dad became a pastor, and through his ministry, I got saved. And I've got 4 sons, and God has called all 4 of them to be preachers, and they all got saved. And just last week, Ben called me and said, Dad, we had 8 saved this morning at Guide Church. You see the story I'm telling you? I'm so glad one man opened his mouth because it's been spreading and spreading and spreading to this very day. Our first grandson was born in Springfield. Caleb brought him out and said, guess what we named him, Dad? I said, what? We named him Jack.
after his grandpa. Jack's 7 today. I don't know if Jack's going to be a preacher. I hope he is. But Jack's already hearing about Jesus Christ. When you open your mouth, you don't know how far it's going to go. You don't know how wide it's going to spread. We won't know till eternity. But Bible Baptist Church, we've got to wake up and open our mouth and tell people about Jesus Christ. Would you stand with me tonight? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads if you would. Tonight, I know I spoke mostly just to Christians. That's what revival's for. And maybe tonight you'd say, Brother Kent, I got somebody on my heart. In fact, while you were preaching this message, there was somebody that was coming right to my face. It's my best friend. It's my family member. To that neighbor. And Brother Kent, I wish you'd pray for me that I could have that courage, that I could open my mouth and tell that one about Jesus. Somebody right now, somebody is on my heart. If you're like that tonight and you'd like me to remember you in this time of prayer, could you just put your hand up high for just a minute? I've got somebody. I've got a face. I've got a life in my mind. I've got somebody that's burdening my heart. Yes. Yes. Hands in every section. Yes. Anyone left? Anyone else? I got a burden for somebody. Yes. Yes. Maybe there's someone here tonight that needs to be obedient. You've been saved, but you've never been baptized. You need to come tonight and say, Brother Kim, I want to be baptized as soon as we can get that tank filled. What do I do next? There's some that need to come tonight and join this church. You've been attending. God's laid it on your heart. You need to come. Don't pray about it. Just obey Him. Who's like that tonight would put your hand up and say, Brother Kent, I've been saved, but I've never been baptized, or I need to join this church. Would you pray for me tonight? Who's like that tonight? Is there anybody like that tonight? Just put your hand up, put it right back down. I want to pray for you tonight that you've got the courage. Yes, I see you. Who else is like that? Brother Kent, I need to be obedient tonight. I want to be obedient to the Lord. Who else is like that? Amen. Thank you. I know tonight I didn't speak to the lost that much, but you know what? I told enough stories about people getting saved. You know you need to be saved, just like my daddy, just like my Uncle Lester, just like my Uncle Cecil. You need to get saved. Maybe tonight there's someone here to just say, Brother Ken, I'm not saved, but I wish you'd pray for my soul. I care about my soul. And I'm going to pray tonight that you'd come tonight and trust Jesus. I'm going to divide the building down the middle. I'm going to come over here to my left hand. If you're in these two sections and you're not saved, but you'd like me to pray for you, maybe you'd just lift your head up and just look at me and just look at me for a minute. And you're saying, I'm not saved, but I wish you'd pray for me. These left two sections. Is there anyone like that? Just lift your head up high where I can see you. I just want to pray for you. Just lift that hand up. I want to pray for you. How about in these right two sections over here? Is there anyone like that tonight? You're not saved, but you'd like me to pray for you? Just hold your head up good and high so I can see your face, and I'll pray for you. Yes, thank you. Anyone else? Anyone else? Yeah, I see you. Thank you. Heavenly Father, we come tonight first praying for Christians. Oh, I'm praying for those that are so burdened for their own daddy or their own brother, their own granddaughter.
that neighbor, that friend, that co-worker. And then, Lord, I'm praying for these tonight that have been saved, but they've never been obedient to follow you in scriptural baptism. I pray tonight they'd come and present themselves. If there's someone here that needs to join this church, they'd come and just put their membership right here at Bible Baptist as we receive members. And then, Lord, for these that are not saved, oh, tonight would be a wonderful night to be saved, Lord. I'm praying that they would just throw down every bit of pride and just come and let someone show them tonight how to trust Jesus. Dear God, this is your invitation. You take it. You bless it. It's all yours. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now look up here and listen to me just a minute. If you got somebody on your heart tonight, I'm going to ask you to go one step past putting your hand up. I'm going to ask you to come down and don't pray for all the lost people in the world. I'm going to ask you to come and pray for that person that's on your heart tonight. If you need to be baptized, Brother Kim's going to be down here. You just come to him and tell him, I want to be obedient. I'm not going to pray about it any longer. I'm going to be obedient. Need to join the church? Same thing. Preacher will be right here. Need to be saved? Walk to the preacher and just say, I want to get saved tonight. He'll have someone pray with you. Folks, let's don't. We're out of time. We're out of time. It's too late. We got to open our mouth. We got to get busy about this. If you need to come, come on. Some are already coming. You come and join them. Come on, sing it out, Brother Sean. This is for you. Come on, this is for you. Amen. Amen. Who are you going to call? What name are you going to call tonight at this altar? What loved one? Come on, sing it out, Sean. Come on. Come on, this is for you. Oh, we got to call their name. We got to call out their name.
Oh, I know.
That person's got my heart burdened. How about you? You been saved? Not baptized? Come on. Come and present yourself tonight. Be obedient. Nothing more to do. Need a good church home? Come and join this one. I've been a member here 18 years. This is a good one. Good place to join.
Coming home, coming home, never more to roam. Open wide thine arms of love, Lord, I'm coming.
I'm going to give you a little homework tonight. Back in the Welcome Center, there's a big basket of our good Bible Baptist tracts that say, do you know for sure if you died today you'd go to heaven? Now, I don't want you to grab a whole handful, but I challenge every one of you to pick up two apiece, two, and go out tomorrow. Don't put them on the back of the commode in the McDonald's. Actually put them in someone's hand and open your mouth and ask them if they can answer this question and tell them about Jesus. That's homework for tomorrow. Two apiece. You can be seated for just a moment. We're going to have our little campaign. We've got a little contest we call Let's Get Ready to Rumble. rumble, and we're going to rumble tonight. We've got two teams that are rumbling. First off, I'm going to need two impartial counters. So let's see, who do I have here that's an impartial counter? Brother Richard Keller, come on and be one of my impartial counters. And you. Jackie Grass. Come on, Jackie. Come on. Give Jackie and Richard a big hand. These two men are my Vanna Whites tonight. And I met Vanna, and you're not as good looking as she is, but you'll do. Now, Richard, you're going to have these two sections and everybody in the sound booth up there in the camera booth. You got them? All right, Jackie, you're going to have these two sections only and on the platform. Me and Sean are on the platform. You're counting us also. That's the way it's going to go. All right, our first team to rumble tonight is Paul and Alice Harris. Stand up, Harrises! Now, the Harrises are what color, Harrises? They're the yellow team. If you don't have to have a ticket, but if that helps you remember, they're the yellow team tonight. And if you said you would stand for the Harrises, stand up for the Harrises right now. Now, Jackie and Richard, count every person standing 1 point apiece. If you're extremely short, hold your hand up so they will know you're standing. And Jackie, I'm standing for the Harrises tonight. How many you got, Jackie? 28. How many you got, Richard? How many? 23. Do any of you have children or spouses that are back in the nursery or out in the bathroom right now? Hold up one finger for anybody that's in the back that's standing for the Harrises tonight. What do you got, Richard? No, fingers. Just fingers, Richard. Count the fingers. Jackie, how many? Four. What do you got, Richard? All right, wonderful. If you're a member of Bible Baptist Church, be seated. Members, be seated. Now, men, count these in multiples of 5, 10, 15, 20. And I'm standing, but I'm a member, I'm not standing, so don't count me. Count them in multiples of 5, if you would. What do you got, Richard? Took a long time to count nothing. How many, Jackie? Zero. Do any of you have a child or a spouse that's maybe in the nursery? Keep in mind, most children are not members. Hold up a finger for everyone that's in the back that's a non-member. What do you got, Richard? Zero. Jackie? One is not a multiple of 5. You were in education, weren't you? All right, you can be seated. Give the Harrises a big hand tonight. Tonight they're rumbling against Jan Capps and Phyllis O'Day. Stand up, Jan and Phyllis. If you said you would stand for Jan and Phyllis, stand up for them tonight. Stand up for them tonight. If you're real short, hold your hand up. These men are counting frantically at this time. All right, Richard, what do you got? 50. And what do you got, Jackie? 53. Do any of you have children or spouses in the nursery that are standing for Jan and Phyllis? Hold up a finger for each one that's in the back, in the nursery, or somewhere else. What do you got, Jackie? One. What do you got, Richard? Two. Two more. All right. If you're a member of Bible Baptist, be seated. Members, be seated. Thank you. Now, count these in multiples of 5, if you would, gentlemen. Do not make me do the math. Multiples of 5. What do you got, Jackie? 35. What do you got, Richard? 40. Do any of you have children or spouses in the back that are non-members that are standing for Jan and Phyllis? Hold up a finger for each one that's non-member. What do you got, Richard? 0. Jackie? 10. All right, you can be seated, and let's give Jan and Phyllis a big hand. Please give my impartial counters a big hand. Thank you, gentlemen. They were wonderful to take that abuse. All right. Tonight, the Harrises did a wonderful job. They came in tonight with 63 points. Good job. But Jan grabbed Paul by the head and rammed him into the corner post while Phyllis flipped Alice into the folding chairs. Jan and Phyllis are our winner tonight with 190 points. Good job. That means Jan and Phyllis are our winner tonight, and also at this point, they're in the running for the grand prize, which will be awarded at the close of the service Wednesday night. In fact, all prizes are awarded Wednesday night. The score to beat tomorrow night is 190 points. Our rumblers tomorrow night are David and Allison Sales. Stand up, Sales. There they are. They're going to be rumbling against Jeremy and Jamie Beard. Right there's the Beard right there. All right, both teams, stay up. Get your eyes open. Who would say, nobody has asked me to stand for Tuesday night yet? Hold your hand up high where they can see you. See them right after. Would somebody tackle that woman, please? No. All right, as soon as we have the final amen, you're welcome to ask all these people. Come on, Brother Kim, I'm all done. Thank you.
Number is 2. The number is 2. Everybody hold up a number 2. Hold up 2 fingers. When you walk out, get 2 tracks. Right? You're going to do it, right? You're going to do it, right? Open the mouth. Remember the message. What was the fella's name we talked to last night? Michael. Michael the Archangel. That's right. That's what I called him at our restaurant, Interurban, and took the missionary and took Brother Kent, his wife, and my wife. And he has promised to come tomorrow night. You pray for him to come. And he said he'd bring some friends because we're feeding. That really interested him, that we're going to offer food, and so he's coming. But listen, let's just open our mouth. That's what we do. Let's stand together. You've been here. You've listened. I'm just so thankful you've come. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Brother Kent, you got some things back there on your table. You're going to be back there with it, and you need a T-shirt. You need some help going to the mission field. That's what Brother Kent used that for. Let's pray. Father, thank you so very, very much for every decision made, and Lord, for just the blessing that we're going to go out of this room and we're going to go tell somebody about you. That's the best thing we can do, is just tell somebody else. One beggar telling another beggar where we found bread. Lord, thank you for that, that somebody told us, that somebody was faithful, and we'll thank you forever for what you did on the cross for us. Bless tonight. Give us rest to our bodies. Bring us back tomorrow with joy bells ringing. In Jesus' name we pray, everybody said, amen. You're dismissed. Go get 2 tracks, all right?
I need everyone to come up to the front, please.
What's that?
Everyone needs to come up to the front.